Welcome to a special 15-year anniversary episode of Stories from the NNI. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Today, it's my pleasure to welcome Qilin Li, Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering at Rice University and co-director of the NSF-funded Nanosystems Engineering Research Center for Nanotechnology-Enabled Water Treatment, or NEWT. Qilin has spent her career developing technologies to address the issues of water scarcity and water quality, two significant challenges facing the country and the world. Qilin, thank you so much for joining us today. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you first got involved in nanotechnology?
I'm originally from Sichuan, beautiful province in southwest China. After receiving my bachelor's degree in environmental engineering from Tsinghua University in Beijing, I came to the U.S. for my graduate study and received my master's and PhD degree from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. I studied absorption of organic contaminants from water using a conventional material, activated carbon. And during my study there, I became very interested in the use of advanced materials for water treatment. So I took a postdoc position at Yale University and studied water filtration membranes. And at that time, that was the newest water treatment material. Nanotechnology was just budding as a new research field, but very few researchers in the field of environmental engineering were involved in nanotechnology research. My exposure to nanotechnology really did not start until I became an assistant professor at Rice University. It was a blessing coming to Rice because Rice had the very first national research center on nanotechnology called the Center for Biological and Environmental Nanotechnology, or CBEN. It was created by the late Nobel laureate Professor Richard Smalley and was founded by National Science Foundation. Even though I never had the chance to work with Professor Smalley, I heard so much about him and his work and was really inspired by his vision to solve the world's greatest challenges using nanotechnology. As you can tell from the name of the center, environmental nanotechnology is a very important pillar of the center's research. So I was extremely fortunate to be brought into the center to work on both environmental application and implication of nanotechnology. And I was brought in to a very strong nanotechnology research community. Therefore, I had tremendous opportunities to work with a diverse group of researchers, material scientists who synthesize and characterize nanomaterials, and physicists and chemists who develop methods to detect and measure nanomaterials, bioengineers who study interactions between nanomaterials and biological systems, and explore biomedical applications of nanomaterials. And so I started by doing research on the environmental fate, transport, and toxicity of nanomaterials, and to look at their potential use as solvents, catalysts, and membrane materials in water and wastewater treatment applications. It was such a wonderful way to start a career.
You talked a little bit about membranes. Can you share a little bit more about the role of nanotechnology in ensuring that people have access to clean water? And this, of course, would be one of those challenges that face the world that you mentioned.
Right. That is a great point, and I really love to talk about it. I talk about this a lot because providing access to clean water for all members of the human society really is a grand engineering challenge for the 21st century. It is one of the United Nations development goals. And it's also, you know, personally to me, the motivation of my own research. When you think about in this world who don't have access to clean water, they are mostly people in the developing world. In the developed world where we live, we have easy access to clean water. When you turn on your water tap, what comes out is already potable water. But the way developed countries supply water requires extensive infrastructure. What I mean is that we have to first take the raw water source, treat it at very large centralized treatment plants, and then transport that treated water through a massive distribution network, consisting of hundreds of miles of pipelines to each individual end user. This method has been effective for us and works on the economy of scale, and it uses very well established conventional treatment processes that utilize very large reactors and require very careful operation. But this scale and level of complexity of this water infrastructure system is very difficult to achieve in developing countries because of the very large capital investment needed for such infrastructure system and the complexity in operating and maintaining it. So I believe a better solution is point of use or point of entry water treatment, meaning we treat the water at the location of the end use. For example, the household water treatment devices many of us have at home are examples of point of use water treatment. I believe nanotechnology can be used to create high efficiency and reliable point of use water treatment devices and systems. So you can build a fairly simple cartridge filters and load the cartridge with different functional nanomaterials. You can have, for example, iron oxide nanoparticles that can remove arsenic from water. You can have carbon nanotubes that absorb pharmaceutical compounds in water, and you can put these nanoparticles on an electrically conductive nanocarbon network that absorbs organic contaminants, bacteria, and viruses, which when you provide it with an electric current can inactivate the absorbed bacteria and viruses and dissolve organic contaminants to regenerate itself. Overall, you can see you can put many different necessary functions to treat and purify your water in a very simple and small device.
You serve as the co-director of NEWT at Rice University. What is the impact of having such a center at the university?
Sure. As you mentioned, that I'm a co-PI on this grant and also the associate director for research at NEWT. To me, the center is an absolute blessing to all of our faculty and students. It definitely provides benefits that are not available through small research grants with one or a few PIs. And I really cannot emphasize that enough, the benefit of center research. Obviously, you get the benefit of continuous funding towards addressing a very grand challenge, as water scarcity problem is not something that can be solved quickly and by a very small number of people. But more importantly, the opportunity to conduct research as part of a very large and diverse team with a highly unified vision, that is a very rare opportunity and is, in my opinion, the best way to benefit from team science. So you've got people come from different disciplines and research fields. They bring in diverse expertise and the different ways of thinking or of approaching a problem. And they also bring in stakeholders from different sectors whose needs are very important to understand when developing solutions to water-related challenges. Within our center, we have chemists and material scientists who are now understanding fluid dynamics and reactor engineering, and therefore can understand the constraints these factors set on materials when they start to design a new material. People who used to work on wastewater treatment now are learning about the certifications necessary for all chemicals and materials used for drinking water treatment. And so this diversity of research has been wonderful, but it's not just that diversity in research areas. The diversity in the ethnical and cultural background of the team has also been wonderful to have at the center. And that diversity makes our faculty and students a lot more creative in developing educational activities. I wanted to really point out that this kind of ethnic and cultural diversity is necessary for water-related research because water is so essential to life. And every culture has its own way when thinking of water and when dealing with water in its daily life.
I want to look a little bit more broadly, not just the research that you're conducting yourself, but your view of nanotechnology over the past 15 years. Can you share your thoughts on some of the most important advances that you feel have been made over that time span?
It's really difficult to name what are the most important, but if I have to name a few, I think precision drug delivery, energy conversion, storage, and water treatment are the most exciting. Take the example of precision drug delivery. The capability of sending a nanoparticle through the extremely complex environment in our body to a target site while having its cargo well protected and only release it upon arrival at the target site is really nothing short of a wonder. And when it comes to energy conversion and storage, the advances in photovoltaic materials and catalysts that allow us to enjoy solar energy at low cost today and are moving us towards a more diverse energy portfolio in the future really gave me hope that we will have the necessary tools to address the global climate change challenge in the near future. But of course, my personal favorite is advances in nanocomposite materials that enable faster, cheaper, and chemical-free water treatments. Among many of the technologies I research, my favorite is desalination using solar energy enabled by nanotechnology. Hopefully that one day will allow us to utilize the massive amount of water in our oceans at very low cost, providing a long-term solution to the water problems faced by our planet.
Could you look to the future and share some of your thoughts about how nanotechnology will play a role in the future?
Sure. And there's one particular challenge I'm very interested in addressing, and that is the aging water infrastructure in our large cities. I live in a large city, and I see how our water infrastructure is aging. We rely on these massive infrastructure systems to support potable water and to collect wastewater. Aging of these systems obviously can cause very expensive and sometimes devastating problems, and that could directly threat our public health. But thinking that we live in the age of big data and smart cities, at the same time, our water systems are not really very smart at all. So we're really not taking advantage of some of the other technologies that have been used in other infrastructure systems. And I think the reason for that is there is a terrible lack of real-time sensing capabilities that allow us to monitor the health of the water infrastructure system, as well as the quality of water that's in that system. But I strongly believe that nanotechnology can help our water systems become smarter with distributed nanosensors that can detect damages in the infrastructure and can identify water quality problems such as the occurrence of microbial pathogens, provide much needed data for better management of these precious assets.
I've really enjoyed chatting with you today, and I want to give you the opportunity to share any closing thoughts that you might have for our listeners.
I wanted to share some of my thoughts regarding safety of nanomaterials. It has been more than 10 years since I started my research, the environmental fate, transport, and toxicity of nanomaterials. That was with Sabin when I first came to RISE in 2006. I certainly support the idea, and I still do, that unintended consequences are a very important consideration when we are trying to develop a new technology. However, I do want to emphasize that we need to use science and data instead of being drawn to fear to direct our action. Anything can be harmful if they're not used properly, and nanomaterials are no exception. So we need to keep in mind that potential health and environmental impact of a nanomaterial when we do our research, but we should not let that become an unsurmountable barrier in the development of nanotechnology for water treatment. the many things we do today in developing new technology for water treatment is really to ensure secure immobilization of nanomaterials in our reactors or systems or this material substrate. So we don't have to worry about nanoparticles escaping the system, getting potentially into our natural environment or even our drinking water sources. So again, cautious, but there's no need for fear.
Thank you for joining us today for this special 15-year anniversary edition of Stories from the NNI. If you would like to learn more about nanotechnology, please visit nano.gov or email us at info@nnco.nano.gov. And check back here for more stories.